ओके नहमदुहू व नुसल्ली अला रसूलिहिल करीम अऊज़ु बिल्लाहि मिनश शैतानिर रजीम बिस्मिल्लाहिर रहमानिर रहीम। अस्सलामु अलैकुम ऑल स्टूडेंट्स, आई होप दैट ऑल ऑफ यू आर वेल एंड यू कैन सी माय स्क्रीन। सो टुडे वी विल बी लर्निंग समथिंग अबाउट व्हाट इज मल्टीपल प्रेगनेंसी। Okay, so the objectives of today's lecture are that with this lecture we may be learning what is the prevalence, the geographical distribution, risk factors of multiple pregnancy, how does it form, what is the classifications, what are the clinical features, what complications can ensue, how to diagnose, assess and manage the monochorionic and monoamniotic, the complicated pregnancies, how to care during the pregnancy, and what is the intrapartum and postpartum management. So starting with the multiple pregnancy, it is a combined joy for the family, for the patient herself, and apprehension as well. Joy because she's going to get more than one kids, apprehension because it is associated with a lot of complications, and the woman is worried that what is going to happen with her and will she be having normal healthy term babies or she may be having any problems. So there is an apprehension as well. Also, because the multiple pregnancy is associated with exaggerated symptoms and signs of the pregnancy, therefore there may be concerns regarding the multiple pregnancy. So commonly, most commonly, it is twins, meaning two babies, or there may be higher order multiples. With increasing assisted reproductive techniques in the world, there are increasing chances that more than the twins would be will be occurring, and there may be triplets or quadruplets or even hexaplets or maybe even more. You may have heard in various news, social media or Google that there are many babies born at one time, but the commonest are the twins. So they occur in around 3% of the live births as a whole. In general, the chances are, the prevalence is increasing, as it has been seen that in 2009, 16 per 1000 women in England had multiple pregnancy, but in 1980 it was 10 per 1000, and it is even more now. The important thing is why we are so much concerned about multiple pregnancy, that it is associated with maternal mortality, which is at least 2.5 times higher than for the singleton births, and perinatal mortality, which is at least 5.5 times higher. And stillbirths and preterm births are very common. The lowest incidence is in Japan and highest is seen in Africa. So it is determined by race. Other determinants are age, increasing age in pregnancy. And see, the women who require the in vitro fertilization are also somewhat higher age group, more than 35. So that combines, the two factors combined there. Higher parity is also associated with twins, and artificial reproductive techniques, as we just told. So what is the maternal physiological response? If there is a multiple pregnancy, even in a singleton pregnancy, you already know that there is a maternal physiological response. All of the body systems respond to the pregnancy, and there are normal pregnancy changes within the maternal body. But what happens in the multiple pregnancy, that as compared to a singleton, there is a greater increase in the cardiac output, glomerular filtration rate, and renal blood flow. The plasma volume is even more increased than a singleton pregnancy, 1/3 more than the singleton pregnancy. And similarly, the red cell mass is also increased by at least 300 millimeters more. Therefore, this results in a greater decrease in the hemoglobin, hematocrit, and ferritin, which was known as the physiological hemodilution. Therefore, the physiological hemodilution is even more. And all the symptoms are very much exaggerated. The most important early exaggerated symptom is the hyperemesis gravidarum. Others may be increased chances of backache, symphysis pubis dysfunction, edema on the body, varicose veins, hemorrhoids, more deep stria, physical difficulty in coping with the care of more than one baby. This is after delivery, problems in the lactation, and increased chances for postnatal depression. What are the risks? There are a lot of risks associated. Some of them is that, for example, hyperemesis was also a symptom, but if it is not managed, it may result in dehydration and renal failure. Multiple pregnancies is more associated with miscarriage. Vanishing twin syndrome, it is more associated with medical disorders like anemia, hypertension, diabetes. There are more chances for preterm birth, antepartum hemorrhage, polyhydramnios, malpresentations and malpositions, risk of operative delivery, including cesarean section, postpartum hemorrhage, and postnatal problems like depression, difficulties in lactation, difficulty in caring for the babies. Similarly, increased fetal risks, for example, increased risk of stillbirth, neonatal death, mainly because of prematurity, but may also be due to the increased incidence of congenital abnormalities associated and other complications of the, for example, the monoperionic and monoamniotic pregnancies. Sometimes one fetus dies, and then what is going to happen to the other baby, we'll be seeing in a short time. There may be fetal growth restriction of one or both babies, increased risk of the congenital abnormality, and this is because of the formation of the twins, how it forms. Therefore, there are chances for anomalies. There may be conjoined, the two twins are conjoined together. There may be complications like twin-twin transfusion, twin anemia polycythemia sequence, twin reversal arterial perfusion sequence. These are complications of the monochorionic pregnancy. There may be cord accidents, meaning there may be cord entanglement, cord prolapse, like this. There may be monoamniotic twins. There may be polyhydramnios, operative delivery risks, twin entrapment. For example, during delivery, the breech, the first twin is breech. The body of the fetus one is delivered, but the head is stuck to the head of the second twin. So therefore, both babies may die during delivery. We can classify the twins or multiple pregnancies on the basis of number of fetuses, like twins, triplets, quadruplets, or number of fertilized eggs. Most commonly, twins result from two ovums being fertilized by two sperms separately, and they are known as dizygous twins. Sometimes, only one ovum is fertilized by a single sperm, but in the course of few days, it divides into two separate fetuses. So those fetuses are monozygous, meaning they originated from a single zygote. They actually originated from the single zygote, which then divided. and this is the cause of the various congenital abnormalities resulting in the twins. On the basis of number of placentae, of course, if it is a dizygous pregnancy, there are two placentae, but sometimes they appear on a gross inspection, they appear to be fused together, but they are two separate placentae. In the monozygous twins, it may be two placentae, or it may be one placenta supplying two more than one babies, monochorionic. Similarly, the number of amniotic sacs may be two sacs separately, or a single sac containing more than one babies. And this is the most complicated type of the multiple pregnancy, monoamniotic. So if we see the twin pregnancy, it may be dizygous in 70% of cases, monozygous in 30% only. When it is dizygous, it is usually dichorionic, diamniotic, everything double because it originated from two separate zygotes. But if it is monozygotic, then there are chances that it may be dichorionic, diamniotic when the zygote immediately splits after fertilization. It may be monochorionic, diamniotic when it splits on the day 4 to 8. It may be monochorionic, monoamniotic when it splits between days 8 to 12. Or if it does not split by day 12 and it splits later than that, then the twins are conjoined. Two twins joined together. Okay, so it depends on these number of days of the division of the zygote, that will it going to be two placentae, two sacs, or one placentae, two sacs, or one placenta, one sac. Okay, so this is how to diagnose on ultrasound. This is a diagrammatic picture of what we see in the ultrasound for the diagnosis of the dichorionic or monochorionic pregnancies. See, in a dichorionic pregnancy, there are two amniotic sacs, and in between that, there is a tissue of the chorion, of the placenta insinuating in between these two amniotic membranes. This is known as lambda sign or twin peak sign. In a monochorionic pregnancy, this insinuation of the placenta within the two amniotic sacs is not seen. And therefore, it just appears as a T, inverted T. See, this is known as T sign for monochorionic. This is best seen in the ultrasound done between 11 to 14 weeks of pregnancy. So it is very important to get an ultrasound between 11 to 14 weeks of a pregnancy, when it is best diagnosed that whether the twins are di or mono. And why do we want to know this? Because we want to predict, anticipate the complications associated with the monochorionic and especially with the monoamniotic pregnancy. This is the ultrasound picture. In the on the right side of the dichorionic twin, you see the placenta insinuating between the membranes, and it is very thick. It appears thick actually. In comparison, see on the left side, it is a very thin membrane. So this is the diagnostic picture on ultrasound. So in patients with the twin pregnancies, if we are suspecting a congenital or a chromosomal abnormality, as in other pregnancies, we can do prenatal diagnosis by various methods. So in multiple pregnancy also, we can do various methods to diagnose. chromosomal or structural abnormalities. It has been seen that there is increased risk of Down syndrome and other aneuploidies in twin pregnancies. Monozygotic twins have a 50% more chance of structural abnormality. See the reason that we discussed just now. We can also see the knuckle translucency in that same ultrasound as we did between the 11 and the 14 weeks, okay, which is a marker for chromosomal abnormalities. We can do an anomaly scan, and we need specially to rule out the cardiac abnormalities. Anomaly scan should be done between 18 to 22 weeks. And if we want to see especially the cardiac abnormalities, we would tend to do it at a later date, like more towards the 22 weeks than the 18 weeks. First trimester serum screening can be used as an adjunct, but separately, the results may be misleading because they were meant for the singleton pregnancies, and for the twin pregnancies, we do not know exactly what the results, the normal results should be. Therefore, it is difficult to compare. Non-invasive paternal testing is with maternal serum. Through testing the maternal serum, we can test the chromosomes of the fetuses. And we can also imply invasive procedures like the Corion-Willis sampling, the amniocentesis, and so on, as for the singleton pregnancies. But remember, for these invasive procedures, then you may have to do separately for each twin. Doing only for one twin will be applicable to that twin only. You may have to do it for separate twins. So what is required? Of course, a specialist care at a place where such patients with complications can be assessed and managed, where there are facilities for doing ultrasounds, for caring for the complications of these pregnancies, and especially caring for the preterm babies that are being anticipated. Okay, so you should inform the patient and the family about what is the diagnosis, what is going on, what to anticipate, and a lot of emotional support is required. What information we are giving to them about the exaggerated symptoms of pregnancy, because the patients may get worried about why she's having so many vomitings, maybe why she's having so much abdominal enlargement, why there is so much shortness of breath, and so on. Antenatal nutrition is of course very important, and supplements of iron, folate, B12, because we studied in a previous slide that there is a high risk for decreasing hemoglobin and hematocrit, and of course calcium and vitamin D supplements. Rest is advised, not resting for the whole time period, but an adequate amount of rest. We have to inform her and educate regarding the risk of preterm labor, the risk for need of the intensive care for the baby, intervention before labor may be required, and there is a high chance for operative delivery. So the patient must be knowing. So when we diagnose twin pregnancy in the first trimester, and ideally if we have done a ultrasound between 11 to 14 weeks and we know what is the chorionicity, then we can advise about the anticipated problems and anticipated interventions that may be required. So we have to remember, when we are giving ovulation induction or giving in vitro fertilization treatment, we must remember and inform the patients that they are going to increase the risk of multiple pregnancy. So we have to be careful when we are prescribing ovulation inductions or in vitro fertilization. When there is in vitro fertilization and embryos are to be transferred into the mother's body, numbers of the embryos that are being transferred is very important. Okay. Weight gain would be somewhat greater than for a singleton pregnancy. Should take an extra 1.150 kilocalories per day. This is extra calories, right? And of course, we talked about supplements. So folic acid is a must for every pregnancy and more important for a twin pregnancy, especially in a multi-parous lady, because there is also an increased chance of folate deficiency anemia. Okay. So we have already discussed this, that ultrasound diagnosis is important when we can also see the knuckle translucency. We need to see the chorionicity and amnionicity. We need to see the lambda sign. We need to do the anomaly scan. We need to look out for the Down syndrome. And then we need serial growth scans for each twin. Each twin, remember, right? Because any one twin can be having a fetal growth restriction, or both may be having it. And it is difficult for abdominal clinical assessment for fetal growth restrictions because two or more than two babies are growing together in the tummy. Therefore, the symphysio-fundal height is not reliable. Okay. In twin pregnancies, the symphysio-fundal height is not reliable. Therefore, frequent growth scans would be required. Pregnancy-induced hypertension is quite common because of increased placental mass. Okay, so is the gestational diabetes. Symphysio-fundal height, I've told you, preterm labor is common because of increased amount of fluid and material inside the uterus. Therefore, there is over-distension of the uterus. Therefore, the cervical length may be shorter as compared to a singleton pregnancy. The role of fibronectin and home uterine activity monitoring is questioned and not reliable as for a singleton pregnancy. So you have to just educate the mother that if you have any pain, if you have any discharge, you have to report to the hospital. Supposing there are symptoms of preterm labor before term, that is before 37 completed weeks of pregnancy, she's having labor pains. The advice may be bed rest, but only bed rest will not manage it. Tocolytics may be considered, but remember there are the tocolytics themselves have complications. And pulmonary edema. Okay. So we have to be very careful when using tocolytics. Prophylactic cervical cerclage has been studied, but it is not recommended for all pregnancies, may be considered on a case-based decision. Admission may be required if the preterm labor is diagnosed, and serial ultrasounds for growth may be done. Amniocentesis for lecithin sphingomyelin ratio, not usually done nowadays. Steroids, again, may be given, but please remember that for multiple pregnancy, steroids in combination with tocolytics can result in pulmonary edema. Therefore, you have to be careful. Okay, supposing it is a monochorionic pregnancy. One of the complications that may occur is twin transfusion syndrome. Okay, one twin to second twin transfusion syndrome. It may occur in the 10% of monochorionic or 5% of monoamniotic pregnancies, and responsible for 40% of the neonatal or fetal deaths in the monochorionic twins, right? So what is there in this twin-twin transfusion syndrome? Abnormal, unbalanced vascular anastomosis between the twins. When they, just remember the etiology, that it just came out from, this monochorionic came out from the single zygote that divided, okay? So it is expected that some vascular anastomosis are present between the two twins. But if they are balanced from one to the other, it is okay, does not result in obvious complications. But if they are unbalanced, one-sided blood vessel transfusing blood to the other, and then in a retrograde fashion, abnormal, so that one twin is being transfused with extra blood from the other twin. Okay, this is known as, one of them is known as the donor twin, one of them is known as the recipient twin. So it results in problems with the both. The anastomosis may be arterio-arterial, arteriovenous, veno-arterial, or veno-venous. Can be any one of these. If you do an ultrasound, you would see single placental mass, same gender. Of course, if it is a monochorionic, it is going to be same gender. There will be oligohydramnios in one sac, which is the donor twin. Polyhydramnios in the other sac, which is the recipient twin. See, the recipient twin is getting polyhydramnios because it is getting too much blood pumped into that baby, into that fetus. Therefore, in the oligohydramnios donor baby, the bladder would be small, would be very much less distended, or may not even appear. And in the other, the polyhydramnios, it is over distended. And similarly, in both of them, there would be hemodynamic and cardiac compromise. In another, this is the staging of severity of the twin-twin transfusion syndrome. What is the severity? Okay, there are five stages. It may be oligopoly sequence. Donor twin bladder is visible, and Doppler ultrasound, the Doppler indices of the arteries are normal. The umbilical arteries, the middle cerebral artery, they are normal. In the second stage of severity, there is oligo or polyhydramnios. Donor twin bladder is not visible, meaning it is so much accentuated now that the bladder is not visible, but still the Doppler studies are normal. In the third grade, bladder is not visible, and there are now Doppler abnormalities, meaning absent or reversed end diastolic velocity in the umbilical artery, or reverse flow in the A wave of ductus venosus, or pulsatile flow in the umbilical vein in either fetus. If it is more severe, one or both twins develop hydrops, fetalis. More severe, they may die. So this is very important. So this can be diagnosed on ultrasound. This is why serial ultrasound is necessary, so that we can look out during the ultrasound scans of the growth of the fetuses, the amount of lichen in the fetuses, and all these things. The viscera are visualized during the, therefore the bladder is visualized, and Doppler studies are done to rule out, to see these problems, especially if you had diagnosed that this is a monochorionic pregnancy. When did you did it? You did it between the 11th to the 14th week of pregnancy. So you know it, that you need to look out for these complications. So if you diagnose it, ultrasound should be done every 2 weeks. Perinatal loss is very high, up to 95%. See, so much important. In patients, if it is not severe, grade 1 or 2, expectant management, or you may consider selective feticide or amnioreduction in the polyhydramnioside fetus, or break the septum, break the amniotic sac septum, so that the polyhydramnios and oligohydramnios are balanced. But more important and more better is the fetoscopic laser ablation of the vascular anastomosis. This is being done in the Western countries now, okay? And it has got good prognosis. Another complication could be twin anemia polycythemia sequence. It occurs in 5% of the monochorionic twins, or 13% of the cases who previously had twin-twin transfusion syndrome. In this case, the anastomoses are not big and multiple, but they are very minute, less than 1 millimeter unidirectional arteriovenous anastomosis, so that small amounts of blood continues to be transfused from one fetus to the other. It is so minute amount that polyhydramnios does not occur, but there is hemodynamic compensation. So the hemoglobin is very much discordant. The donor twin becomes anemic, and the recipient twins becomes polycythemic. Okay, the donor twin can develop so much anemia that it develops hydrops fetalis. Hydrops fetalis in the donor twin develops due to anemia, severe anemia. In the recipient twin, there may be polyhydramnios resulting in thrombosis, and therefore death of both may occur. Or due to thrombosis, there may be cerebral damage, neurodevelopmental delays, right? So if it is diagnosed, you can do intrauterine transfusions for the donor and exchange transfusion for the recipient. And again, laser ablation of the abnormal anastomosis is the best choice if available. Another thing is twin reversed arterial perfusion sequence. It is rare. In this case, there are large arterio-arterial anastomosis between the two umbilical cords. The pump twin, the donor twin here is known as the pump twin. It supplies the perfused twin in a retrograde manner so that it is transfusing to it the unoxygenated, non-oxygenated blood. And usually this is associated with a twin which is having a congenital abnormality, which is achardia, a very rudimentary heart. And that is why this complication develops. So in the perinatal mortality in the pump twin is very high. There may be demise of the twins, hypoperfusion with cerebral morbidity. And again, the management could be, if you can occlude the umbilical cord of the abnormal twin, the twin with the achardia, with the rudimentary heart. If you can occlude that cord using laser ablation, you can do good to the remaining, the other baby. So if there are monoamniotic twins, right? This is also not very common, rare. But we do see monoamniotic. So monoamniotic automatically means that the chorion is also one, of course. And here there is only one amniotic sac. Remember, how did it occur? Division between day 8 and day 12. So because there is only one amniotic sac, so the twin babies are intermingling with each other in that single sac. So there is very high chance of cord entanglement and death due to cord entanglement. And because of the late division of the zygote, congenital abnormalities are very common. So is the discordant growth and birth weight of both the babies. Different, discordant means different. One baby is growing at a different rate, the other baby is going at a different rate. So a very close surveillance by ultrasound is needed. The patients, it has been recommended that these women may be admitted at 28 weeks for fetal heart rate auscultation because a high risk of entanglement and death. And they need delivery very early, maybe by 32 weeks or by 34 weeks at the most. And they should be delivered by cesarean section. So for the twin pregnancies, remember dichorionic, diamniotic, monochorionic, they may be diamniotic or monoamniotic, right? So NICE, the National Institute of Clinical Excellence, that recommends that the timing for the delivery is different in the twins as for the singletons, right? Steroids may be given, but we already discussed that steroids in twin pregnancy should be given carefully. So for the dichorionic twins, it is recommended that they be delivered by 37 weeks. Just compare it with the singleton pregnancy. We may take it even to 41 weeks. Remember, although the term duration is known as 37 to 42 weeks, 41 weeks and 6 days, but usually the singleton pregnancies, they are delivered by 41 weeks. It's normal for them to deliver by 41 weeks. But it has been seen for the twins that if the pregnancy is delayed beyond 38 weeks, there is a very high chance of death of the babies. Okay. So even the dichorionic twins should be delivered by 37 weeks. The monochorionics may be delivered by 36 weeks. Triplets may be delivered by 35 weeks. And we just now read in the previous slide, monoamniotic delivered by 32 to 34 weeks. Okay. So what should be the mode of delivery? It is dependent on the case that you receive. If the first, the leading twin, we call it the leading twin. Leading twin is the twin which is coming first, which will be delivering first. Okay. So if the presentation of the leading twin is vertex and the second baby is also vertex, so we can conduct a vaginal delivery safely. If the leading twin is vertex, but the second twin is breech or transverse, then vaginal delivery can be conducted after the first baby is delivered, then you can do an external cephalic version or an internal podalic version for the second baby and deliver vaginally. Or you may decide for a cesarean section if the estimated fetal weight of the second twin is larger than the first twin. Then we may decide, or there are signs of fetal growth restriction or hypoxia in the second baby, then deliver better by cesarean section, because there is a time interval between the baby delivery of the first twin and the second twin. Therefore, the second twin, while its vaginal delivery, is at a greater risk of hypoxia. Okay, so you have to be careful. If the leading twin is also non-vertex, meaning it is breech or transverse, then of course you are delivering it by cesarean section. So if a twin pregnancy is in labor, we have to ensure availability of blood and blood products because we may anticipate postpartum hemorrhage. IV access with at least a 18 gauge cannula, a large bore cannula. Experienced team, the obstetrician, the midwife, the neonatologist, the intensive care, neonatal intensive care team should be present, and they should be experienced to deal with the problems that may be occurring with the mother or the babies. Fetal monitoring. Remember, there is more than one fetus, so you need a CTG separately for each twin, not just for the one twin. Okay. When the first twin is delivered, as for a singleton, the cord may be clamped. Then, by an abdominal examination, we assess the lie of the second twin. If it is longitudinal, we let it deliver. If it is not longitudinal, it is transverse, then we may correct it by what is known as external cephalic version and then deliver it. Or we may insert one hand in the vagina, in the uterine cavity, perform an amniotomy and deliver the second twin by internal podelic version and breech extraction. Of course, there is a risk of placental abruption in all this. Infusion of oxytocin may be used, especially for the delivery of the second baby. Okay. There is a risk of postpartum hemorrhage for the reason that the uterus was over-descended. Therefore, after delivery of both the babies, there is a sudden shortage, decrease in the size of the uterus. Therefore, the uterus may become atonic and would bleed. Therefore, active management of third stage is required. And you should also be prepared if postpartum hemorrhage occurs. Your team should be ready to deal with postpartum hemorrhage. Okay, what time do we have? We still have 8 minutes, okay? Okay, I'll discuss this single fetal demise a little later. I just want to elaborate some of these things again. Okay. When we are talking about external cephalic version, what do we mean is that once the first twin is delivered, okay, the cord of that baby is clamped, then the obstetrician would do a abdominal examination to assess the lie of the second twin. If it is longitudinal, then an syntocinon infusion would be set in so that the uterus contracts adequately and the second twin is delivered. If it is not in a longitudinal lie, the second twin we are talking about, if it is in a transverse lie, then through the abdominal hand, the lie would be corrected to a longitudinal. This is known as external cephalic version. And then again, syntocinon infusion started, amniotomy is done, ARM, artificial rupture of membranes, is done, and the second twin is delivered. There is also an option that if the second twin is in a transverse lie, then you insert your hand in the uterine cavity, grasp the baby's feet, bring them down into the vagina, and then do rupture of membranes and deliver as breech. This is known as internal because your hand went inside the uterine cavity, podelic because you caught hold of the baby's feet, version, you turned them and brought them down, internal podelic version, and breech extraction. Then you extracted the baby as breech. Okay. This type of a delivery is allowed for the second twin. But remember, this type of a delivery is not allowed for other cases of breech presentation, right? It is allowed for the second twin because in such a case, when the first twin has already delivered, the uterus, cervix, and vagina are well dilated and there is ample space for us to do all these maneuvers. Please do not compare this with a breech presentation in a singleton pregnancy. Please do not. Okay. All right. Okay. Sometimes out of the two babies, there is single fetal demise. One fetus dies. When one fetus dies, the other is at a risk of coagulopathy and fetal growth restriction. If it was a dichorionic fetal demise, we would just do a surveillance with the blood coagulation tests, ultrasound, serial ultrasound for the fetal growth, and deliver as soon as the baby is mature after 34 weeks. In the monochorionic twins, there is vascular shunting from the, because there were abnormal vessels between the two babies. Therefore, there is vascular shunting from the survivor to the dead. And there is falling blood pressure of the dying fetus resulting in hypovolemia and hypoxic change in the survivor. So both the babies are at a very, if one fetus has been dead in a monochorionic pregnancy, there is a very, very high chance that the other baby would also die. So you have to be very much alert in diagnosing this and deciding when to deliver the second baby in order to save that baby. Because if this demise occurs very early, for example, even before 24 weeks of pregnancy, then of course we cannot save the second baby, right? But if the second baby is at a gestational age, when it can be saved by delivery and caring it in the neonatal intensive care, then it should be delivered. So the risks are maternal disseminated intravascular coagulation because of release of toxic substances from the dead baby, risk of preterm, spontaneous preterm labor, mortality of the surviving twin, and renal cerebral cystic lesions in the surviving twin. The surviving twin can also encounter neurological damage because of hypoxia, maybe thrombosis because of the DIC, cerebral atrophy again due to hypoxia, ischemic infarctions, again due to hypoxia. So delivery has to be managed as case-to-case basis, depending on the pulmonary maturity, evidence of acute compromise in the survivor, and postnatal monitoring of the baby, whether available or not. Otherwise, the patient should be referred to a center where such cases, such preterm babies can be managed. So with higher order multiples, spontaneous triplets, very high, so the complications would continue to rise, right? Should be delivered by 36 weeks by cesarean section. No chance for vaginal delivery because the third baby is at a very, very high risk for hypoxia. So in conclusion, first trimester ultrasound, very important. Regular antenatal care, very important. Monitoring each baby for fetal growth restriction and for preterm birth. Prompt intervention whenever a complication has arisen. Tertiary care delivery, you have to manage the timing of delivery. Close neonatologist and pediatric follow. So you can do your further reading from your known textbook, the obstetrics by 10 teachers, or by Dewhurst textbook. If you need to read more, if you are interested, you can search Google for NICE guidelines regarding multiple pregnancy and green top guidelines. Okay. थैंक यू
मैडम, एंड करें मैडम,
एंड करें मैम।